what I am not going to do is give elaborate introductions of my colleagues here, because that would take up all our time. Sherrilyn Ifill of the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, the LDF, Evan Wolfson of Freedom to Marry, Nina Perales of MALDEF, Nina Totenberg of NPR. So let's get started. Sherrilyn, the Supreme Court decided the Fisher case this year, which was the case about affirmative action and admissions. Now, the word I would describe to use that opinion is incomprehensible. So I would ask you to tell a admissions officer at, say, the University of Texas, where the case came from, what can you do and what can you not do in terms of affirmative action for race as a result of Justice Kennedy's opinion?
Well, I would tell the admissions officer at the University of Texas, you can do what you did. What the Supreme Court said in the Fisher decision is that a school has to demonstrate that there's no available, race-neutral, workable alternative. And the University of Texas did precisely that. They adopted that top 10% plan, in which any student who graduates in the top 10% of any public high school in Texas would be admitted to the University of Texas. And what they discovered after that was that they still were not able to achieve the kind of diversity that they need for their educational goals. This is a public institution, educates most of the leaders in the state of Texas. And what they discovered after the top 10% plan, for example, was that 80% of their classes had only one or no black students. So they tried a race-neutral alternative, and it didn't work. And as a result, what they did was not scrap the race-neutral alternative. They continued to admit 75% of their students using the top 10% plan. But for 25%, they decided to engage in a holistic, individual review of each student's application, of which a race in that consideration was, as the university says, a factor of a factor of a factor of a factor. And if you want me to go into the details of how they used race, I can.
But I thought Fisher won the case. I thought she won. She was challenging it. So what do you mean doing?
You thought Fisher won.
She didn't? No?
No, she was challenging, and she lost below. And the question before the Supreme Court, right, the question before the Supreme Court was whether or not, well, one question was potentially, were they going to strike down Grutter?
But she won a remand.
She won a remand. And so on remand, I would tell the University of Texas.
They don't have to change
anything. Well, listen, my hope as the president and director-counsel of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund is first and foremost that the judge in the case would allow those of us like MALDEF and like the LDF who represent black and Latino students to be part of the case so that we can expand the record to support the kind of diversity that's needed in that case. So it's on remand, and I would tell Texas, your plan makes sense.
Full speed ahead.
Full speed ahead.
Nina, Shelby County, the Voting Rights Act case. I would say the consensus seems to be, the decision in that case was that the formula that the United States Department of Justice uses now under the Voting Rights Act to determine which parts of the country are covered is now unconstitutional. The consensus seems to be Congress is not going to revisit this issue. There's not going to be a they are not going to create a new formula. So what should people take as the lesson going forward of Shelby County? How do you protect Voting Rights Act in an era of voting rights when Section 5 appears to be a dead letter at this point for the states that used to be covered?
Well, in order to get to moving forward, I think I have to say something about the decision itself. First of all, that it's hard to overstate the negative impact of the decision. It was a very, very powerful and negative decision for voting rights. By gutting the coverage formula, they essentially removed, at least for now, the preclearance requirement for those jurisdictions that came in under that formula. And although the court did not invalidate the nationwide prohibition on discrimination in voting, it essentially removed a really important tool for enforcement. Up until now, jurisdictions that were covered had to prove that their voting changes were non-discriminatory before they went into effect.
That was the pre-clearance process, submitting those changes to the Department of Justice.
And it was a tremendous part of voting rights because it blocked discrimination before it ever went into effect. It shifted the burden to the jurisdictions themselves. Now the burden has been shifted over to us. And that means, in practical terms, that some discriminatory voting measures will go into effect because they haven't been blocked through Section 5 and will have to be challenged after the fact. In very practical terms, in Texas, which is where I happen to live, we had two statewide laws that had been held back by the preclearance provision, a really pernicious discriminatory redistricting law, and also the strictest photo voter ID law in the country was also restrained because of Section 5. Following the decision in Shelby, the Texas Attorney General announced that the voter ID law would go into effect immediately, and Texas is now taking steps to put that into effect. And luckily, we challenged the redistricting plan on other grounds as well, so we have, I feel fairly positive that we will prevent that redistricting plan from ever going to effect, in part because Texas itself has now replaced it with something else. I think we have to, and I see so many friends out here, and I forgot to thank Ford and to say what a pleasure it is to be here with everybody, but I guess I'll quote much of what Julie Fernandez exhorts us to do, which is to put our big girl pants on and start moving forward, which means we're going to have to play to our strengths. Our strengths are our connection to our own community members and our ability to spot, evaluate, and litigate discrimination when it occurs. And so moving forward from here, we're going to have to work more strongly under Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act and under other laws and be in very close touch with our folks on the ground to help us spot discrimination as it's happening. Instead of being able to get those little weekly summaries from the Justice Department about what's going on, we will be talking among ourselves and sharing information about what might be discriminatory and talking about whether to challenge it.
Okay, Evan, sitting there all smug because you won your case, right? So this has been an extraordinary time for the freedom to marry. The growth of the in states and, of course, the DOMA decision. How would you describe the interplay of lawsuits and politics going forward for the freedom to marry?
Right. Well, the main thing I'll say is I have my big girl pants on because we are not done. We did have a really good day in the Supreme Court in the marriage cases, and we had a really bad day in court the day before with the voting rights case, and so we're all not done on marriage, on LGBT inclusion, and of course on the kind of society we want with full equality for everybody. And these things go together, and we can take some lessons from the victories we saw in the marriage cases, because in part thanks to important lead support from Ford, we were able to make a case to the country, not just to the court. And the strategy of Freedom to Marry has always been to engage the country, to engage the conversations, to spark conversations, to get people to think about real people who are affected and the legal change that needs to happen, while invoking the avenues of legal work and legislative work and lobbying. We work very, very hard to create a climate around the court that said America is ready. America is ready to end this exclusion, to end this discrimination. We did a drumbeat of stories of real couples and how the denial of marriage harms families and helps no one. And it was an intentional and significant and heavy lifting piece of work because the mantra has always been there's no marriage without engagement. We really have to engage. And I think
together. It's also a pun.
Indeed.
No, I think that was the point.
I can't put anything by you. And I just want to underscore why the decision was so important, why decision day for us was so important, although incomplete. And that is that the Supreme Court did two very important things in the marriage cases. Obviously, there were two cases. First of all, it restored the freedom to marry in California, which obviously makes a tremendous difference in the joyous lives of many, many families. And we saw couples beginning to marry and so on. But what it also did was restore California as an engine state, helping to move the country forward. We now have about a third of the American people living in a state where gay people can share in the freedom to marry, up from zero a decade ago. And the other big thing that the Supreme Court did, and this is, I think, one of the common themes that we're all dealing with, is while all discrimination is intolerable, and we know that our work has to be in the personal lived experience as well as in the law, it's not enough to change the law, but it is a prerequisite to change the law. While all discrimination is bad, arguably the worst is when it's practiced by the government itself against groups of people, whether it's segregation or voter suppression or exclusion from an important opportunity and right, such as marriage. And what the Supreme Court did on our day was it turned the federal government from being the number one discriminator against lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people in this country to now putting its moral and indeed legal weight on the side of our families. Still plenty more to do. We have 37 states, as Luis said, that discriminate. But the federal government finally has now been moved onto the side of fairness and the Constitution and the freedom to marry when it comes to gay people. And that's a big step forward.
Okay, Nina, you've covered the Supreme Court for quite some time. Not since the Warren. I mean, you were not there during the Warren Court.
Actually, the first year I was there was the last
was
year.
Was it really the last year? But wow. That's
yes. Don't tell
you,
that
you
one.
Were, you were Nina obviously started covering the Supreme Court
when
in
I was
junior
four.
High. Yes, that's right. Yeah, that's right. So you have mostly not seen the court in its liberal heyday, but there are some who believe that this court is conservative in a different way than conservative courts of the Burger Court or the Rehnquist Court. Do you think that's true?
I think that's a fair criticism or a fair observation. But of course there are now, when Kennedy votes that way, there are five conservative votes consistently. And that was not true in the Rehnquist Court. That was not true in the Burger Court, even more so. So it just, you know, Justice Brennan used to say, when he used to ask his clerks when they came to work for him, what's the most important rule here? And they would say things like, well, it's the First Amendment, it's the Fourth Amendment. He says, no, five. You've got to have five votes. Mm-hmm. You don't have five votes, you don't have squat. And more often than not, they have five votes. In addition to that, I think that in varying degrees, the conservatives on this court are much more, for want of a better word, movement conservatives, but also culturally of very different kinds of conservatives. And when I first started to cover the court and I didn't know anything, I would call up somebody like Phil Kurland, who was considered a conservative, who was a sort of a Felix Frankfurter type conservative. And that was a very different kind of conservative than these folks who actually grew up in the 60s, some of them, felt quite antagonized by it and left out, and some might even say aggrieved. Even Justice Thomas had a sort of totally different reaction, not the same as Justice Alito, but a very different reaction than most of the people in this room. And there is a certain sense I would have to tell you that you all talk to each other and you don't talk to those folks. Now, the one interesting thing about those people is increasingly they do know gay people and they do know their children have friends who are gay and relatives who are gay. But the minorities who they know are like the people in this room. They are not people who can't vote, who are prevented from voting. And that is an experience they really do believe has gone away.
So when you think about the Supreme Court, do you think, boy, I can't wait to get my cases there? Or do you think, how do we, like, settle and, you know, what litigation, you know, you're in the business of litigation.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's your attitude towards the court?
When I was a little girl in the 80s, in the 60s, you know, the idea that you would get your case heard in the Supreme Court was huge, and that, you know, that in the civil rights world, you know, we'll take it all the way to the Supreme Court.
That famous phrase,
yeah, you know, that's so exciting. No, we're not that anxious to get into the Supreme Court at this moment on the issues that we care about. And it's actually pretty important because Nina said, you know, that five is the magic number. But actually, with this Supreme Court, four is also a magic number because that's what it takes to get a grant of certiorari, to hear a case. And so we have a Supreme Court that's hearing fewer cases than previous Supreme Courts. but that's being actually, I think, quite aggressive about wanting to hear cases that they want to hear, right? And they want to hear some of the cases, I think, because they have had longstanding views of the sort that Nina Totenberg has described about issues that they believe they know a lot about. And they think they know a lot about race. And this is one of the kind of strange anomalies of this court. You know, I was struck by Justice Scalia in the human genome case, you know, how he kind of conceded, like, I don't really know this stuff. This science stuff is really difficult. But, you know, the five justice conservative majority really believes they know a lot about race. Now, I don't know where they got all this knowledge, but they seem to feel themselves, and so that when you think about the Shelby case, and we were litigators in that case, and we argued that case, you know, and you look at this record that Congress amassed over the course of a year, you know, 9 months and the 15,000 pages, everybody's heard it, the 90 witnesses, all this work that Congress did in 2006 to determine whether or not this coverage formula should go forward. And the Supreme Court simply says, you know, we just don't believe you, right? We didn't have any hearings, but we just have our own sense. I do think it kind of extends from this experience that they've had over decades where they really feel that they're experts. And so Nina's point is actually really quite well taken, that what's important for us is this connection that we have with the communities of people that we represent, the ability to bring these stories. That's why I talked about getting into the Fisher case on remand, right? The stories of our clients are what, you know, creates a record and allows us to educate lower court judges about what's really happening, about what's at stake, about what the consequences are, about how race has played out in the lives, not of elites, but of average people, of the kind of people that we represent. And we've got to keep advancing that story, not only to the Supreme Court, but to the rest of the country. You know, when I talk about the Voting Rights Act, I constantly tell people, you're going to open the paper and all you're going to see is conversations about redistricting at the state level and at the national level. And I want them to understand that most minorities' lives are controlled at the minute level by the school board, the town council, the county commission, the water district, the municipal district. That's where the power is exercised, and that's where the mischief happens, and that never makes it to the front page of the Washington
Let's
Post.
Let's talk a little about the intersection of law and politics, and let's talk specifically about the Republican Party. Because 50 years ago, when the Civil Rights Act passed, the indispensable people, obviously Lyndon Johnson was the president, but you had people like Everett Dirksen, who was the Republican leader in the Senate, Hugh Scott in Pennsylvania. I mean, these were Republicans
Hamilton Fish
here in New York. I mean, you had Republicans who were deeply committed on civil rights. Nina, you covered the Supreme Court with Potter Stewart, Lewis Powell, Sandra Day O'Connor, David Souter, John Paul Stevens, all Republican appointees to the Supreme Court. When you talk about the civil rights agenda, your governor is Rick Perry, and your Texas legislature, much in the news recently, is not the moderate Republicans of old. How do you, Nina Perales, how do you talk to Republicans now?
Well, we talk to them the way we always have. In Texas, forever, we've had to build coalitions of Democrats and Republicans to get things done in the legislature. The sort of new added factor is that a lot of the folks in office who would otherwise be supportive of what we're talking about are very worried about getting primaried from the right, because it's a strong phenomenon in the state of Texas. So in a sense, they are in conflict with their better instincts. But we've still been successful. I can tell you recently, Sherrilyn was describing the top 10% program, which allows students who graduate near the top of their class to be an automatic admit to UT Austin and also Texas A&M at College Station. UT wasn't particularly happy with that program for a long time, and in the legislature there was an attempt to cut it back, and this was something that we felt was really important to preserve. And our work with rural Republican legislators, showing them on a very pragmatic level how many of their rural high school graduates were now going to the flagship university as a result of the top 10% plan, allowed us to build a coalition of people who were voting the interests of their district, both urban and rural, to preserve the top 10% program. So that's an example. The only thing we have to try to work around is the concern about being primaried from the right.
You know, I think that one of the things that Evan and his colleagues have done that was really quite brilliant, they really followed the model of Thurgood Marshall. Mm-hmm. They found, straight out of central casting, clients. Edie Windsor was the ultimate because she was 83 years old. But if the court had taken one of those other cases, they would have found almost, maybe not quite, but almost as appealing people. And I think really because we've had 50 years of racial progress in this country, and in some ways you're going to have to go back to the drawing board mm-hmm. and have a kind of public campaign of understanding with very sympathetic clients, doing what in fact the right has done in finding Abigail Fisher. Mm-hmm. I don't actually think Abigail Fisher under the University of Texas program would have gotten in if she'd been black. If you look at the facts in the case, but they actually struggled to find a client, as mm-hmm. I understand it. But you folks are going to have to do that more and not
but
assume
Evan, you
that
have
everybody
an,
knows.
You have an advantage mm-hmm. because Republicans have gay kids too, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
And
some have black kids.
Some have black kids,
right.
But not as many.
And we're not even talking about stuff. I don't have
a study handy, but I just am, you know. But Republicans do. And it's that's been a big advantage for you, right?
Yeah, it's funny. It used to be that the argument over who had advantages, and of course these communities are not distinct communities. These are, as you just pointed out, these are overlapping communities. We are overlapping communities. But it is true that the gay experience generally is different from the African-American experience generally, which is different from the Latino experience, which is different from women's experience. And what we need to do is find the commonalities and the things that work across lines without, you know, overly making everything the same or saying everything has to be one cookie cutter model. It is true that gay people have the advantage of, as we famously say, being everywhere. We are part of everybody. We are part of every community. We're part of every, pretty much every family. Of course, the disadvantage is we come into life and have to find our way to our community, to our cause. We are not born in a support network. We're not born in support of families who share our oppression and experience and can warn us when we walk out the door. Sometimes they're the first ones we're worried about. So there are advantages and disadvantages or, you know, comparative strengths and weaknesses. What's more important, though, is that we focus on, as Nina suggested, some of the lessons we can learn from the common struggles that we, the big we, have engaged in over the years. And it is very true that there are certain lessons from history and certain lessons from our overlapping movements that we have to continue to claim and embrace and put forward. And one of them is the importance of engaging and making the case outside the courtroom, not just in the courtroom. It isn't only that Edie Windsor was such a perfect epitome, who also, you know, corresponded in age to the justices and allowed for a lot of people to relate in lots of ways to the injustice. But we had drumbeated hundreds and hundreds, thousands and thousands of stories over years and years and years. And even then, as everyone knows, the shift in opinion took a very long time and almost had to catalyze itself as we went forward, and we're still not done. So there are many, many lessons we can really...
Poor Evan. Yeah. Evan and I go way back. Evan always says, you know, our problem is we've gone from impossible to inevitable without like having anywhere in between. Mm.
Right.
And you're not inevitable.
Right, we have to do the work.
Let me just say that, you know, we still do very careful work with our clients. You know, when we were arguing the Shelby County case in the Supreme Court, we brought our clients up from Alabama, and I sat with them. And so the client who I was sitting with was Earl Cunningham, who's 81, a venerable old gentleman of the South, you know, lived through the civil rights movement, was active, just a wonderful courtly gentleman. Who, you know, is in the same age cohort of some of the justices. They're not feeling him. You know, he was sitting there when Justice Scalia described, you know, the Voting Rights Act as a racial entitlement, and he gasped. You know, we'd instructed, you know, we can't say anything, we can't, you know, amen, we can't hiss, we can't, you know. And he just gasped, and we both kind of clenched in that moment. And I think this goes to, you know, another important difference in these two areas that we're talking about, and that's, really goes back to kind of what I think Luis was saying at the very beginning, is people just kind of have absorbed the idea of progress. The fact that the civil rights movement has had tremendous successes, which it has had, has allowed people to feel that this is over. We did that already. Right. It's not that the story is not compelling. They just feel like they heard it before, and they don't want to hear the same story. So frankly, when we're advancing, what I think, you know, when we're talking about one of our clients, Nicole Cogdill, who worked at a retailer and was fired along with other managers because the owner thought that having blacks out on the floor ruined their brand image, I think that's a compelling story. I just don't know how much people, or certainly the Supreme Court justices, are interested, you know, in the details of that kind of story. So this idea of kind of being exhausted with the conversation on race, which we've had quite moderately, really challenges us to do really what Evan has done and what Nina is suggesting, is kind of reinvigorate the story and demand that the story be heard. Because this is almost like, you know, I talk to my kids about this all the time. You get sick, you get an infection, and the doctor gives you, you know, an antibiotic, and you start feeling great the second day, and you stop taking it. What do they always tell you? Take the full course, because it may come back even stronger, you know? And I feel like that's America on race. You know, we're in day three, and we just feel terrific, you know? And so we want to stop taking the medication.
Yeah, but
we got to take the full course.
You missed one thing about that.
What?
The antibiotic makes you feel better, mm-hmm. but you're not proud of yourself. We have some reasons to be proud of ourselves mm-hmm. in this country,
yeah.
but we're overproud.
That's right.
And it really is painful for a country, I think, to say, well, we thought we did it. We have a black president, for yeah. Christ's sake. And
what more do you want, for
yeah.
God's sake?
And now you're telling us that we're really racist still? Mm-hmm. That's a very hard thing for people to accept. And I think that it's almost an unsalable message. Mm-hmm. That's why I said, I think having the story you just told about not hiring people because mm-hmm. it hurt the branding, I actually think that is the kind of story that is mm-hmm. unrefutable mm-hmm. if you have the evidence and really sort of comes up in people's face.
But pardon me for pursuing my obsession here, but Republican allies mm-hmm. for decades. Mm-hmm. Bob Dole, mm-hmm. you know, indispensable in the reauthorization of the Voting Rights Act. Mm-hmm. How do you envision in a system which pretty much requires bipartisan cooperation for anything substantial to get done, you know, except for rare moments like 2009 and healthcare? Is there anything you can do about that?
Well, let's say a couple things. First of all, let's remember that it was just in 2006 that the Voting Rights Act was reauthorized, right? And we all know that the vote was 390-33 in the House and 98-0 in the Senate, right?
And signed by President
George W. Bush, as in 1982 had been signed by President Ronald Reagan when it was reauthorized. So we recognize that it was overwhelmingly bipartisan, and we also recognize that the House of Representatives had changed a lot since then. So we do know that. But the reality is that there are many of those Republicans who I think, and this kind of goes to Nina's point, still have their better selves. I mean, we are in very early days yet. And we're happy that people like Congressman Sensenbrenner have already, you know, spoken out and will testify next week, and that Eric Cantor has expressed an openness. You know, every year there are a set of Republican congressmen who go down to Selma, Alabama with John Lewis. To walk across the Edmund Pettus Bridge and, you know, celebrate that great march and the violence that happened and the courage of the protesters. So I would just start with those, you know, because what did they think they were doing? There are Republicans who have taken very powerful stands on voting rights. And the party, we're talking about a party that's in struggle in all the ways that Nina talked about. You have, you know, a set of that party that is providing this challenge from the right. You have a kind of old guard that's left over. You have people who I think have a genuine feeling about the future of this country, and then you have those who I think are just frankly irresponsible. And so it's a churning party in turmoil. And I don't think anybody here can predict at the national level how that's going to end, but it will end simply because it must. It will turn in on itself.
Well, I'm sorry.
I did want to add that with respect to certain issues in Latino civil rights, I think we see a sensitivity among perhaps more state and local Republicans. The one nice thing I will say about Rick Perry today is that he said that Texas did not need an Arizona-style papers, please law, the 1070 law. And this does relate back to the Supreme Court as well, because just in the last term, we had what I consider a real victory in the striking down of most of the provisions of the Arizona law, even though there was a remand on the so-called papers, please provision. There is an awareness that some strategies are more short-term than others, and especially with the burgeoning Latino electorate, I think even Republicans who are concerned about getting primaried from the right also have to think about their longevity and the longevity of their party.
But that's a sort of classic political dilemma that we are seeing being played out in real time now in the House of Representatives, where you have a national Republican Party mm-hmm. that says, you know, we cannot elect a Republican president if, like, every gay person, young person, woman, and a Latino hates us.
Yeah.
You can get reelected to the House of Representatives with all those people hating you. In fact, that's probably a net benefit for a lot of those House members who are worried about someone even more conservative primarying them, right? I mean, so it comes back to that same issue. Evan?
Well, you know, Dr. King used to talk about the methodologies of social change, and one of the things we've worked very hard to do is to make sure we use all of them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, here we have legal champions, and, you know, I have the advantage of having let go of my litigation career with my Supreme Court 5-4 loss apogee. and instead look at the multiple methodologies. And I think the biggest answer to your question really is it probably is going to get a little worse before it gets better, but it's not just through a litigation strategy or even the telling story strategy, important as those are. It's going to be through political organizing and engagement and electing and defeating the people we need to elect and defeat, and that's out there, but that's what's going to have to happen, and it's the divide you're talking about between national and district is precisely people who are seeing that coming, and knowing that even within districts, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but even in Texas, there are demographic shifts underway, and not only with regard to Latinas, but with regard to the coalition you just described, the young, gay, people who see a different vision of the country, and that's going to come to Texas too.
Yes. Oh, you think?
Yes.
Like when?
Well, not 2016.
Uh-huh.
But it will come.
But it will.
I mean, the number of Latino native-born kids turning 18 every day in Texas just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. We had a state demographer, an Anglo man, who caught a lot of flack for saying that Anglos in Texas stopped reproducing at replacement rates 20 years ago, which is a true fact, but a hard fact for a lot of people to hear, even when it comes from the state demographer. Our state is going to change dramatically.
We talk about these, you know, large political currents like, you know, the rise of Latinos both politically and in terms of, you know, political influence. The Supreme Court, there are just 9 of them. I mean, how much do you think these large political movements affect, or does all that matter which president appoints the replacement for Justice Scalia? I mean, you know.
Well, a good deal hinges on that kind of thing. But I think on some issues, legacy does matter. I think that some members of the conservative majority on the Supreme Court do not want to be on the wrong side of history with gay marriage. And you can see that a social movement actually has, if not changed their views, at least made them hold their fire. But that is not where they are on race and ethnicity. They think we've done that, and that one should be very rigorous about not allowing discrimination. They do. They subscribe to that, but in a very, I guess they would say, meritocratic way. And so, you can't. So they would be against affirmative action consideration of race. They probably, if you ask them, might even be against consideration of legacy. Admittance to colleges and law schools.
Sherrilyn, but what about that point?
Because
I think Nina really puts her finger. You know, John Roberts' famous line in the Seattle schools:
yes.
the way to stop discrimination on the basis of race is to stop discriminating on the basis of race.
Yes.
It did not persuade you, I think.
No.
So, but that is a widely held view, especially among, it looks like, five justices on the Supreme Court. What's your answer?
You know, if it were that easy, if it was just about raw power, you know, and a lot of it's about raw power, but not all of it's about raw power, then we would have lost much more than we already have. I mean, take, for example, the Fisher case, which we did not lose.
We're gonna have to check on this exactly.
I'm with her.
Do you really? You don't think that? I thought the remand. Anyway, well, we can just torture.
Which we did not lose, and I'll tell you, it's okay even if we disagree, because we could have lost. They could have said we're relooking at Grutter, and
they did
wrong,
not say that.
Right, and they didn't say that. So why didn't they say that? You know, before, about a week or two before the decision came out, I decided to look again at Parents Involved, the case you mentioned, the Seattle case, and I wanted to read again Justice Kennedy's concurrence in that case, and that case did not come out well for those of us who are seeking greater integration and supporting voluntary integration. But in his concurrence, he talks about, you know, kind of affirmative action and diversity, and he offers a kind of a full-throated support of diversity. He thinks it's important, and I just felt strongly that there was no way between 2006 and now he would just reject everything that he said, which would be required if he were to overturn Grutter. And I also believe that one of the successes that we've had in the civil rights movement, and one of the successes that we've had as litigation, and this is, again, the relationship between mobilization and litigation, is that the course of time has actually created, I think, a belief, and we see it in all the polls, people actually think diversity is a good thing. Mm-hmm. People don't think that's a bad thing. People have problems with words like quotas, preference, right? I mean, who likes those words, right? But people do get the idea of diversity. People do think that if they go into the university, that's where they're going to meet not just people who are like them, but people who are different than them, right? Most people are not trying to go to schools in which it's exclusive and only people who share the same values or have the same background or have the same race that they grew up with. The university idea of just kind of entering the world and learning about the world really is there. And there are ways in which we've affected what Americans think about race. They may not always act the way they want to think, but they do think that diversity is important. They do think that racism is a bad thing. That's why they're so crushed by the accusation that Nina describes. And I wanted to say that she's right about that. That's why one of the shifts we have to make is to help people understand that it does not require you to be individually, personally, affirmatively racist for race to work in a way that negatively affects the lives of minorities. We have to help people understand who we are as Americans, how our minds work, what implicit bias is, how we respond to people that we see, and what they can do to actually manage their reactions to people. And I think once we allow people to understand that it's not about the individual racist, you don't have to have a big stomach and a cowboy hat and a nightstick. You know, that's one period in time and one set of people. It's the legacy of the history that we all have inherited. It's the way we move through an incredibly diverse society. I love visiting Europe, but you know, I'm always anxious to come home because I just love the diversity. I love seeing different people. As Americans, we take that as a matter of course. And so there are ways in which we did affect society positively, and I think that holds the Supreme Court in some way.
Nina, just let Nina say something, and then we'll move to questions from the audience.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And sometimes I crave shifting the argument a bit. For example, you guys, from your point of view, you're going to get screwed on voter ID laws. And maybe you'll get a few of them struck down by states. And maybe you'll be able to prove in a couple of cases that they're discriminatory, intentionally discriminatory, and they'll fall under Section 2. But at some point, you're going to have to figure out a way to get the public to realize that voter ID laws either are discriminatory or that you can overcome them. So what I'm thinking of are, for example, trucks that getting states to say, OK, we're going to have vans that go out into neighborhoods for weeks, 4 weeks to register people, so that people who can't get there can go to the van that's three blocks down. It takes money, that's true. Maybe you have to get it from the Ford Foundation. maybe you have to sort of pressure people in state legislatures. Okay, you say there's fraud. Let's help you make sure there's not fraud help us register people properly. And the other thing I wanted to say is I see a lot of people bring a lot of cases, and I still think that having won so many, that the civil rights community sometimes doesn't think strategically enough, and parents involved is one of those. That involved two places that had voluntary school desegregation. One was Louisville, and one was Seattle. And Louisville had been under court order, and when the judge said, okay, the court order is removed, they said, you know what, we kind of like this, we're going to keep it. Well, they'd had discrimination by law for over a century. And that they were different from Seattle, but they litigated those cases in the Supreme Court together, sink or swim. One of us goes, both of us goes. Well, they both went. And I thought that was a travesty.
Okay, let's go to some questions. There we go. So raise your hand, say your name, ask us a question, don't give a speech, please. Yes, sir.
So I'm Ted Shaw, and I want to pick up Nita Totenberg on your last point and say that in Louisville and Seattle, there are two things that happened. One is that, as Sherrilyn has been pointing toward in Fisher, black folk who attempted to intervene, represented by the Legal Defense Fund, were not allowed to intervene by the court. And it wasn't because the court didn't understand the significance of that intervention. You may remember during the oral argument that Justice Scalia, at one point, went off in a critical way, attacked black school board members or raised critical questions about them, and black parents. There was nobody there to speak for them. Actually, we were there, but we were sitting in the courtroom, having been denied intervention. Mm-hmm. And that's not accidental. And that's typical of many of these so-called reverse discrimination cases. There was a point in the argument when the question of whether the school board was relying on a remedial justification, the lawyer for the Louisville school board answered that he was not. Those of us who were sitting in the audience were seething at that point because we had a different argument. And so what I'm saying is that this is not accidental. It's significant. In these cases, we have been marginalized and rendered voiceless, not because we haven't sought to bring our issues to the court. There are a set of arguments that aren't being made because we're being excluded, even though we have the most at stake. That is what Sherrilyn is speaking to, and it's what happened in Fisher.
Ted, by the way, is the one before predecessor of Sherrilyn at the LDF. Yes.
Hi, Sherrilyn.
Hey,
this
Maya.
Is for everyone, but Maya Wiley from the Center for Social Inclusion. Sherrilyn, you said Americans want to think differently from how they actually act and the opportunity on implicit bias. If Trayvon Martin's death and this verdict represents nothing else, it's the opportunity to lift up how race actually works now. What evidentiary opportunities do you all see in getting that introduced more into legal action?
Thank you, Maya. I just came from LDF's annual meeting with capital punishment attorneys at Airlie House in Virginia, and we had the pleasure of having a great presentation by someone very well known to you and to Rachel, Phil Goff, and he did a presentation on masculinity threat. This is he did this the day before the verdict in the George Zimmerman case. And we spent some time talking about this, and I can't kind of go into it, but basically what he showed us was something really important, and it was about the ways in which the most important issue as it relates to the use of force is actually masculinity threat. And that even, you know, a self-professed racist police officer, right, was less likely to shoot a black civilian if he didn't have a high masculinity threat, right? If there were certain codes that didn't click for him in terms of threats to his own masculinity. It was a fascinating presentation. And that's what we spent time talking about. And we've been talking about this with implicit bias, not only in the criminal context, but in the civil context also. It's beginning to introduce this important evidence, this mind science evidence that shows how we react at the trial court level to begin to educate judges and juries about the ways in which we automatically respond to certain stimuli, and also to talk with people within the legal profession, with judges, with prosecutors, with police officers, all of whom have discretionary authority, about what they need to do to slow down that process so that they can manage their automatic response that they're having to certain stimuli. You know, people have to remember that, you know, Thurgood Marshall didn't himself sit down and say, I know what we'll do. We'll get a black doll and a white doll, and then we'll have some school kids, and they'll come in a room and they'll pick one, right? They had to get with social scientists, they had to get with the great, you know, Kenneth Clark, to figure out how to present, to dramatize, to demonstrate to the court the harms of discrimination. And we're doing the same thing right now, trying to figure out how we present that evidence.
It is interesting how you talk, I mean, the cultural changes that have gone on. I mean, I've spent a lot of the last month covering the Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman case. And with those of us at CNN, as you may know, we had a long interview with one of the jurors. And it was just such a fascinating study of someone, you know, who was completely dismissive of the idea that race had anything to do with the case, or that she, and you know, but I mean, they were all this sort of coded language. That's how they talk, and they. And you know, that's, and Anderson Cooper mentioned, you know, just in the course of this, that you know, he's interviewed members of the KKK who say, well, I'm not a racist, but everybody's not a racist.
Right, but let me say, the reason he says that I'm not a racist is because it's not socially acceptable to be
exactly,
a racist.
Okay. Exactly.
So that's good. Let's hold that
that's
to
good,
the side.
Yeah.
But then there's this other piece of what does it mean to respond in a racial way? And
exactly.
One of the problems is this whole myth of colorblindness. This idea that you are supposed to be looking at me right now and not see my race is so absurd. We have taken it to a level that people now think to observe race, and that means also to manage their own reactions to race, means that they are racist. And we have to provide another way for people to be able to understand what it means to look at me and notice that I'm African American and not be racist.
One of the things that really struck me in the last few days after the verdict has been the power of people doing what actually Luis did a few moments ago, where he talked about the conversations he has with his kids and what it means to be a parent of color, a child of color, and the conversations they need to happen. I think more of that in the national discourse, more of those stories, more of those personal disclosures of what the parenting experience is in communities of color, what the fears, without the labels, because I think everyone knows we're not supposed to be racist. Mm-hmm. So let's not have an argument about that.
Right.
Let's just make it real for people.
Eric Holder did the same thing yesterday at the NAACP.
That, yeah. I think, has been very powerful and important.
Sorry, all the way in the back.
Hi, I'm Deepa Iyer with South Asian Americans Leading Together. And I think maybe the question's for Sherrilyn and Nina Perales, but open to anyone. So I think that the Supreme Court decisions you've talked about really reflect the fact that there's been this growing xenophobia and racism in our country. And the communities that I work with, primarily Asian Americans and South Asians, have felt that especially since 9/11 and with anti-immigrant sentiment. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times we're either seeing as having no race or as foreigners, the spelling bee champions or the terrorists. And so I'm kind of wondering if you could share some strategies for solidarity building in this diverse America as we become a majority minority country to build a stronger racial justice movement that goes beyond litigation.
Well, I'll take a stab just actually in the wake of the Trayvon Martin case, because you know, all of the attention now shifted to could there be a federal prosecution, and so people have been looking at the federal hate crime statute, and we've been talking about it a little bit, and I've had conversations with, you know, with Tom Perez, who's the head of the Civil Rights Division, and others, and it's really interesting to me. You know, there have been over 140 hate crime convictions in the last 4 years. I get that this is a label, but I'm going somewhere with it. So 140. You know, so we're talking about, remember what this statute protects against, someone, you know, bodily injury, you know, assault, murder, kidnapping, because of someone's race, color, or national origin. And if you look at the actual cases, they're Sikhs, they're Latinos who were, you know, run off the road and almost killed, they're African American, you know, it's a full range. And so one of the things I'm very interested in right now is not a litigation strategy, but talking with communities about unearthing this. You know, I've been asking people, did you know that? Do most Americans know that there were 140 convictions, not cases brought, convictions under the hate crime statute in the last 4 years? And if you begin to really look at those stories, you see this opportunity for commonality. So I really want to see people in the African American community beginning to share around that space. This issue that you talked about, it goes back to the story of violence. I mean, you have to understand that there are two issues that are shared across class, certainly by all African Americans and by most racial minorities. One is the issue of the fear of racial violence or ethnic violence. When you live with that you know it's out there and it could happen. It is a way you have to socialize and organize your whole life in terms of where you go, what you tell your children, and so forth. We don't talk about it a lot publicly, but it's real. The second one is the question of dignity, and that's the racial profiling piece. Because the reality is, whether it's driving while black, whatever kind of racial profiling it is, it cuts across class. It is a matter of absolute dignity to know that you can be any place. And I've been in some places where, you know, I'm highfalutin. You know, I'm in a great environment. And there's nothing else that can just snap you to the precariousness of your position than to have someone say, excuse me, you know, what are you doing here? Let me see your ID. Mm-hmm. You have no idea the indignity of this. Mm-hmm. So those stories, I think, do need to be presented. That's why I think the racial profiling issue is such an important unifying issue.
I have an answer as well.
Please.
Since Deepa mentioned that she had I think it's tremendously important for us to organize across our communities and share our techniques. Because most of my work focuses on litigation, I know that we've been very eager to share, and this is also responsive to Maya Wiley's question as well, over the past, I don't know, 5 to 7 years, we've begun to really work the Arlington Heights factors into all of our cases.
Spell that out for those who are not.
I am just about to do that.
Yeah.
I think it's tremendously important. And this also goes to Nina's comment that judges, Supreme Court justices as well as other judges may think we're sort of past the issue of race or we've come so far, how is race really relevant anymore? So even when we have cases that aren't necessarily mostly about racial intent, we are still working in racial intent evidence. And the Arlington Heights factors, of course, from an earlier Supreme Court case, talked about what some of those factors are. I think we did it to tremendous advantage in the redistricting litigation that we did, but we also do it in our anti-immigrant litigation as well, which means that on the one hand, we're talking about preemption, and we're talking about the Supremacy Clause, and we're talking about the conflict between federal and what a locality may be trying to do in terms of regulating immigration. But you bet your booty, we have got all kinds of evidence in there that the mayor of the city said, well, of course we know we have a problem with illegal immigration. Go to the schools and look around. Right, because he's got special x-ray glasses that lets him look at brown kids and say that they're all illegal immigrants, right? And the lady in town who said, we need this ordinance because my job was taken by a Spanish-speaking woman. You know, and also on voter ID. Now, voter ID is going to be about a lot of other things, but you bet we put in evidence that in Texas, when they passed that voter ID law, it was constantly and inextricably tied up with the stated threat of non-citizens registering and voting, and how all of that anti-immigrant hysteria was fueling the voter ID activity in Texas. So yes, I think it's tremendously important, and I also think that if you're doing any kind of civil rights litigation now, because although the justices think they're past it, we have had some success, whether it was Lulac versus Perry or other cases, in putting in front of, especially the ones that are still listening, not the ones that are going la, 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 which we have a few of those now, but the ones that are still listening are still finding this evidence compelling enough to vote in our favor.
Last question.
Hi. Emily.
You are? Good.
My name is Lupita Gonzalez. I'm a social justice leadership coach, originally from Texas. So my question is this. Given that Texas is the second largest state in the U.S., given that there's been a lot of issues around civil rights here recently with, for example, the abortion, and Wendy Davis. Actually, I just saw on the cover of Texas Monthly earlier today, it's Joaquin Castro, Julian Castro, the mayor of San Antonio, and Wendy Davis holding her tennis shoes. So I guess my question is this. What is Texas's role in helping shape civil rights, given what's happening as of late, and also, I guess, in shaping civil rights across the nation?
Go for it.
Well, Texas is a huge state. Now, you're going to, like, that was the perfect question to get out all my Texas chauvinism. But I will try to stay as neutral as possible and say it's a huge state. You're absolutely right. And I think in many ways, other states might say, well, what happens in Texas? That's just what happens in Texas. But I think that Texas does have a role to play. We already elect so many representatives of color, especially in local government. As Sherrilyn was saying, most people's lives are affected primarily by what's going on in their local government. And we elect a tremendous number of Latino, African American, and Asian American folks to our state legislature and to our local bodies as well, that I think in some ways we can be an engine of leadership, particularly for people of color. But we also have such tremendous challenges. We have so many people becoming eligible to vote who are not getting registered because there isn't enough of an infrastructure to register and do get out the vote with the folks in our community. And I really do think that the sort of next generation of voting rights issues are going to be around participation and around access to the ballot. I mean, vote dilution is still alive and well, certainly. But I think people should be really excited about Texas and places like Texas, but also very realistic in terms of what it's going to take to bring us into greater participation.
I spent last week in Texas with Cecile Richards of Planned Parenthood and Wendy Davis doing a sort of cross the state tour. So don't read that Texas Monthly story. Wait till my piece comes out in New York. Anyway, we're out of time. So this was pretty great. Thanks. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you to our panel.
We have to go now.
Another round of applause for our panel.